This program is brought to you by P. Murphy & Associates, successfully providing IT professionals to Southern California businesses.
Hi, this is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do? And today's guest is Leonard Zane. And you want to be called, nobody knows you by Leonard, so we'll just call you Zane.
Right, everybody uses my last name.
Right.
I like it that way.
Okay. So tell us, what do you do? Because you have a fascinating career.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You're kind of like the Renaissance man.
Well, I started originally, was going to be a dentist. I didn't know what I wanted to do. My older brother was a dentist. He went into dental school, and I had no idea what I wanted to do. And I thought, well, he was 5 years older than I, and I thought, well, okay, that sounds good. You work for yourself, has science involved. And so I went into that, and I worked at it. I finally got into dental school, which wasn't easy, and then I found out I didn't like that. And so then I left. I went into the military.
Okay.
Came back to school, got into international relations. I got a degree in that.
Now why did you pick, I know you didn't like dental, but you didn't stay in the science field. You went into international relations. Why'd you do that?
Because I had a friend who was majoring in it, I liked what he was involved in.
Okay.
He would tell me about the things they were working on, and it was fascinating, and all these multicultures fascinated me. And I got more and more interested in that, and so then I took that as a major, and then I enjoyed it very much. I did much better in school, too, and I also took economics as a minor at that time. And after that, then I went out and worked. I got a job in technical marketing. I was a sales engineer, and I was going to school at night, working on my MBA. And then as that progressed, I eventually got into business management of architecture and engineering firms.
Okay.
And then after that...
Okay, let's stop. I just for the audience, because we're all, I'm trying to follow. When you made these decisions, like from the international relations to the economics, because those two mesh up in my head, those mesh up. What were you planning on doing? Did you have any idea?
Well, international relations and economics, I wanted to get involved in international trade.
Okay.
I wanted to do something involving trading commercial items between different countries. You know, I might work for, let's say, a company in the United States that would be trading with maybe Japan or something like that. And I was just fascinated by that whole interaction and wanted to do that. But then when I got into marketing, I enjoyed that domestically, actually, rather than international. And then it evolved. While I was doing this, after I got the MBA, then I backed into media.
Okay.
Doing creative writing and media production, and that was completely accidental. It had to do with my interest in music,
which is a lifelong interest.
Yes, but I didn't know classical music. I came from San Bernardino, small town. We heard country western all the time, but you know, you didn't hear any classic stuff, and except when the better schools would send orchestras to my little grade school, and the members were always from some other school that was fancier mm-hmm. than ours, and I remember clapping so hard that my hands would hurt. And then eventually when I came to Los Angeles and heard more classics, then I discovered this music by Rachmaninoff, and I thought, my God, what kind of a man wrote music like this? And that's when I researched, and I thought somebody should do a movie about him, and nobody did. So then I studied screenwriting at Sherwood Oaks College, and
That was up in the Valley, right?
That was on Hollywood Boulevard.
Oh, really?
And
but you were still working your
marketing
job?
Oh, yeah, I was working in marketing and all that. And so then I was I got involved in researching to do a screenplay about him, and I studied with some really great screenwriters. I was lucky enough to do that, and then it took 11 years to write that screenplay.
Mm-hmm. And then you had to go pitch it, right?
Well, yes, that was happening a lot. I think I stopped counting the rejections after, I think it was 167. Though we did actually, one producer did want to do it, and that was arranged. We were actually going to have the movie done, and but the studio CEO got fired. And it was a very prominent studio, and when that happened, then the executive producer called me up and he said, "Well, Zane, I'm sorry, but we lost him." And so that's the way it goes.
How do you do? There are people who watch this show, and they're doing film and screenplays. What would you tell them with 168? I mean, that could be really 167, right?
The first important thing is if you believe in it. You know, if it has a truth to you, then I would say it has some core there. If you have learned more or less how to do it, you know, you do have to develop the craft, and that takes study and it takes work, a lot of work. But if you believe in it, and certainly this executive producer did, you know, when he first called me up and he said, "Look, I read Concerto, that's the name of the screenplay. I like it, I want to do it, you know, this is great." And this was a very prominent producer who had done major feature films. And it doesn't always work that way, though, because it may take many projects. I've done many since then.
And, oh, yeah, I know. I mean, do you ever get used to all that rejection, though?
The first thing, Marlene, is, first of all, you've created something that never existed before, and you've actually made it real. Just that alone, that alone is the creation. I mean, did some painters ever think their paintings would sell, you know, or whatever? And now here's a screenplay, it has the potential. So the first thing is, I would say, the satisfaction in doing it itself. That is number one. Of course you want to share it. You want to see it succeed, all these things. But those are secondary. And so the rejections, I found, okay, fine. And some people would tell me why. And I would learn sometimes, oh, you know, that should be improved and I could do this or that. And sometimes I wouldn't agree and I would say, well, no, this is why I want it this way. And but it's part of actualizing yourself. It's part of realizing, making concrete what you have inside you.
And then, where is it now?
Oh, it's all over the place. It's inside and out. Since that time, I've done many works. I did actually produce a film. That was an adaptation. It was not an original. That was The In Outside the World, which was a science fiction short story by Edmond Hamilton I had read when I was just a kid. Changed my life forever. And many years later, I ended up doing it as a film and for TV. And
tell me the story. Tell us the story about...
Well, it's about a huge crisis that humanity faces, the biggest crisis they've ever faced. And the main character is, he's a high international official. In this case, I made him the UN Secretary General. And he goes to this otherworldly place to try to solve this enormous problem that there appears to be no solution for. And in this place he goes to are some of the greatest human beings in history that we know, and even of the future that we don't know. Okay. And he wants to get help from them to address this problem. And then in that, everybody eventually in the story meets a person from a future that is so distant that they cannot even imagine what this is. And this person turns out to be the last human being that will ever be. And to me, a very powerful story, not just because of the plot and so on, but the theme of the story, which is really basically that means are far more important than ends.
When you did the adaptation, was that easier than writing an original screenplay?
Oh, sure.
Yeah, by far.
Yeah. The screenwriters I've studied with, most of them had never done an original. Edward Anhalt never wrote originals. He wrote Beckett, Young Lions, Man in the Glass Booth, The Day Christ Died. None of those were his original. Ernest Lehman wrote one original. That was North by Northwest. He didn't do West Side Story. That was an adaptation, Sound of Music. The King and I, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, those were all adaptations. Colin Higgins, who had written Harold and Maude and Silver Streak.
That's one.
Harold and Maude was original. Silver Streak, he said, was inspired by.
It's one of my favorite
films. Is it?
So,
yeah.
It's up there.
Oh, yeah. It's a lot of fun. That was original with him. The other one that he did, Silver Streak, he said, was inspired by North by Northwest. And that was funny because Ernie Lehman said, North by Northwest was inspired by The 39 Steps, the book, the novel, even though it was an original screenplay, it was an original story. So, but originals are tough, but most of my things have been original.
Well, your latest book.
I've got a few latest books.
But the one that's set in 2038.
Yes, I have two. One is in 2038,
yes,
and another is in 2039. Introverse is a science fiction story set in 2038, and that involves a family, two families actually, and children, but it's this huge cosmic metaphysical adventure. And that starts, we finally built the super collider at Waxahachie, Texas, and this leads to big things. The other one that I think you may be referring to is The Dreaded Generation.
That's a very scary one. I mean,
that's scary.
To me, it's 2015, so we're 23 years, and you're talking about all this stuff, and I thought, you know, it's very plausible. It's very, very plausible.
Yes. The Dreaded Generation takes place in 2039, and it and its sequel, I wrote something called Mickey's Move as a sequel to The Dreaded Generation. They are what I would call Crichton-esque type stories, and they exist as both printed novels, audiobooks, and I don't have audio theater for those. I do for Introverse. We have a 3-hour audio theater of that one. But I call them Crichton-esque. Michael Crichton, many years ago, had been a neighbor of mine. And he always used to say, never let them dumb down your stuff. And could we read maybe notes on what Dreaded Generation, just the introduction of it, of what it says.
You can read it.
That's the one with the, here it is.
Yeah, you want to read it?
Okay.
You
let's
can
see.
Read it, it's yours.
Let's see. Because I think this is very powerful, and I'm trying to avoid this. This story is a cautionary tale that I really hope doesn't happen.
What made you write this? Because...
Let's first cover this. We all knew this time would come, and by 2039 it has. Nuclear weapons have become affordable and portable, and in possession of diverse terrorist groups throughout the world, groups called SCARMs that threaten entire nations, fanatic groups that blackmail entire nations. What can be done when any country, even the proud, great, and supremely powerful United States of America, cannot protect its own people? And what I liked in doing this was the main character is a young woman. She's about 28, 29 years old. Her name is Diane Tenska. And anyway, now for your question on why did I do it?
Yeah. I mean, it's you know, sometimes we can detach more if it's 50 years because you think, well, I'm not going to be around. But 20 years isn't, I don't know if I'll be around then either, but 20 years isn't that far out in the future.
Well, I also do have a science background. I was a grants manager at Caltech for 3 years, actually, in the fuel cell research group. But I've always had a scientific bent. And on Introverse, for example, the consulting scientist on that was John Clauser, who discovered quantum entanglement. So I've always had a science inclination. And anyway, in this case, Marlene, we really do face, by mid-century, that this will be true. Nuclear weapons will, in fact, be affordable and portable. What are we going to do? How does it play out if we don't change? If we don't change how we operate?
Right.
How is this going to play out? So I wanted to, I was frightened in writing it. I want everybody to be scared and also thoughtful and reflective on experiencing that tale. My gosh, we don't want this to happen. We don't want it to happen to our kids and our grandkids. And it does indicate in the story what could be done, and especially the sequel, Mickey's Move. The Mickeys, by the way, are the military-industrial complex people that President Eisenhower was extremely worried about. And in this time, the Mickeys decide that they're going to take over, that they're going to keep world stability because things are falling apart without it. And that's a scary story too, but it has, I think it presents great hope. And but the dreaded generation is grim, threatening, very realistic. And I do draw on a lot of my international relations background and research to support that, just as Michael Crichton used to on his things.
Oh yeah, your background's very heavy, very, very heavy politically. I mean, you know all of these countries that are involved in this and the politics over the last 30, 40 years. And
well, I don't want this to happen. And humanity, there was a Russian scientist, I think he came up with this, there are types of civilizations. For example, a type one civilization can control all the energy of its planet, so it can control the weather, earthquakes, everything. Mm-hmm. That's called a type one civilization. Michio Kaku talks about that a lot. There's a type two that controls all the energy in its solar system, in its star system. And a type three, I think, controls all the energy in a constellation, and a type four is like all the energy in a galaxy, which is, you know, approaching Star Wars kind of thing. They are actually between a type three and a type four. Well, anyway, humanity, which goes back to hominids beginning no earlier than 7 million years ago, we have progressed now, very recently, to a type, well, we're a type zero right now, but we're right on the edge of possibly becoming type one. That is the crucial test for a species of making it to type one, because you have enormous powers of annihilation available to small groups, even. And so even Dreaded Generation doesn't, it's not about annihilation of the human species, but it is about tremendous catastrophes that I believe can be avoided.
So you think we may make it to type one?
That's the goal we all should feel.
After how many millions of years?
About seven, but you know, civilization is only, what, 50 to 100,000 years old, something like that. So, and technology has progressed so rapidly recently that our wisdom hasn't caught up with our technical capability. And therefore, we have a chance now, if we think about, instead of thinking about, I don't like that country's religion or their political system or the personalities involved. You know, I don't like Vladimir Putin or something. You know, he's too short and he drives cars I don't like, or whatever it is. No, we should be thinking about a really big long-term picture here. Can we make it to type 1? What will it take to be type 1? Can we survive it? If we can, we will go on. We will go on a very long way. And even if we fail in this century, it doesn't mean we're going to be annihilated. It just means we're going to go through some tremendous traumas that I feel we shouldn't have to.
Well, that's a good answer. What else are you interested in writing about?
Well, I've written my son once when he was 8 years old asked me to tell him a fairy tale. So I like writing, you know, things for kids. I did do that. And I like, this Captain Midnight book here. This is a documentary thing that I actually summarized over 800 stories from old-time radio that were told in the post-World War II era. And I summarized those stories.
We liked Captain Midnight. How long did it take you? Did you have to get the rights? What did you do to do this?
Well, Captain Midnight was very easy because it's a public domain character now. Actually, the owner of the character actually formally surrendered the registration in, I think it was 1990s, you know.
Why?
Something like they didn't want to be associated with it anymore. They just dropped it. And so the character was out there, and then a person had gone to Ovaltine Wander Company's headquarters in Villa Park, Illinois, and he had taken a tape recorder, and he spent several days there. They welcomed him, and he tape recorded notes of all these scripts for like 9 years of Captain Midnight. And then he wrote the wartime book that was like the first 4.5 years or so, and then I, or 5 years, and then I did the balance from 4.5 years from toward the, well, 19, let's say 4 years, 1945 to 1949, I wrote the balance. So that was easy. It was, he let me use his notes, which was very kind of him, Stephen A. Callis Jr. It was very generous of him to let me do that because he wasn't getting around to doing that book, and he finally said, well, you go ahead and do it. And so that book I wrote in like 4 months.
We'll have to, this is Captain Midnight. Let me hold this one up. The Now, people, are there Captain Midnight fan clubs and everything like that?
Couple of small ones. They're not much.
Okay. So how is this book being distributed?
It's on Amazon.
Okay.
And in fact, a number of my books, Interverse, is also on Amazon, and some more are coming out on Amazon. That's available, and it's been reviewed. And another neat thing is we actually built some devices that were only daydreams in those years. And what we did was one of these things was called a pocket locator, this device on the back cover here.
Okay.
And that was a handheld miniature radio transceiver that used tiny vacuum tubes, and it actually did fit in your pocket. Had a range of 4.5 miles.
Oh, really?
Which we tested it, and the original handy talkie that the U.S. military carried, that was a 5-tube thing about this size, that had a range of 1 mile over land and more over water. This 4.4, I think it is, and then if you get up on a 3,000-foot mountain, it's 100, 150 miles. And so we actually built that device. It took us 4.5 years, and we published the...
Is that patent?
No.
Okay.
So we did an article in CQ magazine in October 2010, I think it was, and so that article was published on how we built Captain Midnight's pocket locator, as it was called.
And people, I've been reading these mysteries, murder mysteries by J.D. Robb.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but before you continue, I want to give credit to Toru Kawabata, who is the electrical engineer who actually built the device. I supervised the planning of it, but Toru Kawabata is in Japan. He and I have never met. And he took this project on. I just wanted to give him proper credit for that.
But I've been reading these books, and she's up to 2058. But it sounds like what you're talking about in the books, the communicators and everything else. And Yeah, it sounds very similar to what you're talking about.
But it's 2058.
2058. Mm. 2058, she talks about in one of her early books, well, not her, about urban wars in the 2020s. So
I guess,
you know, so when you started talking to me about that, I could relate. Now talk about, though this is completely different.
One thing I wanted to footnote to what you said, friction is easy. It's easy to get our midbrains going and to react to something hostily. Being reasonable and working things out with joint teamwork, that's hard.
It is.
It's easy to fly off. It's tough to be rational and to interact with mutual respect. And that's what I think is a key in the coming international things, not to mention communities and neighborhoods.
Well, you know, the technology is going so fast, but emotionally, we have not kept up. And psychologically, we have not kept up either. You like what you're talking about, learning to be reasonable, learning to work in teams, you know, all the things that can happen between people. It's got to be, somewhere we have to get along. I mean, somewhere we really do. I mean, so how do you handle that now? Because the technology will always be, I think technology will always be ahead of the norm.
Oh, I love that question, Marlene. That's really a good question.
What? But the technology?
How do we do this? Yeah.
It will always be ahead of the norm.
I've studied into that many years before this. Strangely enough, I found it actually begins with anatomy. It begins with the fact that our brains have evolved over millions of years just for hominids, not to mention scores of millions of years for species before us or reptiles. Well, there's something called the reptilian brain, or the R complex, as it's called. Mm-hmm. It's about the size of an orange. It's right in our midbrain, and it's very passionate, and there's good things about that. It makes for great love and passions. There are great things about that. But it's also very sensitive to stress, extremely sensitive to stress, because our ancestors, lizards doing push-ups on rocks back there, were worried about being eaten in the next 5 minutes. And so,
exactly,
you know, they're always looking around and doing the push-ups. And you had to look out. Something big might grab you and eat you. Well, we still have that midbrain. And then we have these cerebral hemispheres that are added on, that where we do a lot of thinking and we do more, more poetic things, more artistic things, plus more intellectual things, more love, romance becomes much more important with the rest of the bells and whistles we have inside our heads. Well, anyway, but we're still far more sensitive to stress than pleasure. And this, by the way, is what media news is about. Media have learned, just experimentally, pragmatically, that stress sells. And so what you do if you are a news media you merchandise stress, and you will get people's attention that way, because stress sells, and scandal or sensationalism, that stuff grabs our attention just naturally. We naturally gravitate to that. Well, but the result is those messages have been found to be about 4 times more negative than positive, mm-hmm, even the volume of the content. So it makes us think the world is actually worse than it is.
Yeah, that's true.
We're sensitive to this. We don't know how to deal with this. We're gradually learning that, maybe things are better than what we tell ourselves they are. That's the first step. Then it's, if we notice that, and we all are in the same boat together, we're all human beings, we're put together basically the same way. If we realize we're in that same boat, then we can work together and kind of reason our way through this if we don't just blow our tops.
If we don't have the beliefs behind that.
Yeah, there are always beliefs.
You've got to work on the unconscious mind. I mean, from my reading, is not 88% is unconscious. So you have to know what's unconscious to bring it up to.
You have to bring it up, and you have to respect your unconscious.
Right.
And the fact that most everything that's there, you put there.
Right.
And so when you...
But we don't know you put it
when,
there.
No. And so when you become more aware and you deal with therapists or whatever it is, this stuff comes up. And then you can maybe face it, deal with it, and get support from professionals and clergy and your loved ones and your friends and what have you to get through the human fragility that tends to make us very delicate and easily cracked. We can gradually get stronger and be able to face these truths. And if we can do that, then we can actually make progress in working through these things.
I think it starts with ourselves.
Always.
And then move on.
Always starts with the individual inside. Yeah. You know, forget about, the world is screwed up or this or that. No, it's here.
So you've got to work on that. All right. Now, we've been winding in and out of here. So what were you doing? Did you have... with your other career? You always had two careers going at the same time, I gather.
Yeah, well, I guess multiple. And yeah, of course, I have family to raise, too.
Well, I don't know when you saw them. You want to know the truth?
I'm sorry?
I can't imagine when you saw them. You've been doing all this other
stuff.
Well,
they do tell me now that they wanted to see me a lot more than they did. And though I did raise my son from the time he was 8 and a half.
Right.
But my daughter felt left out a lot. And of course, I was trying to support, you know, things even when I wasn't together with my former wife, who is a wonderful person. There were a lot of economic pressures, and so.
You're wanting to do this. I mean, imagine you're very torn between your day job and your working and what you want. This.
I wouldn't say torn.
Okay, you managed to put it together.
Yeah, I would say fascinated.
Okay. So what were you doing in between this? I mean, I just want you to be, you know, we have to be real about this. So what was going on and how were you making money while you were trying to do some of this other stuff?
Well, I was, after I was in sales engineering and then I went into management of architecture and engineering, I became a contract consultant and then eventually I became a management consultant, having my own practice, so I was self-employed. So I'd be going out there, finding more clients and mm-hmm. pitching to them, seeing how I could help them, contracting with them. And I did okay. I didn't do, you know, I didn't make a fortune, but I did okay. And
now, what did you exactly do when you were a consultant like this?
I would help, before I became a consultant, I would handle, for example, making proposals for projects, contracting for the projects, which was often very tedious to do mm-hmm. and very delicate process when you're dealing with clientele. Contract also with consulting engineers, you know, structural, mechanical, electrical, civil, and all those, you make subcontracts with them. So I would be doing that. Then I would be doing budgeting, cost accounting. I even designed cost accounting systems. I implemented those so we could track the financial performance of the projects and try to, you know, make a profit as we did things. And then personnel management, you know, work with people, help them on the job, counsel, you know, staff who were running into interpersonal problems or things like that. Taxes, well, I hated taxes. We would hire CPAs for that. But that was that whole process. So then I would find smaller firms that anywhere from a married couple that had a little architectural firm to, I think the biggest I consulted with was 126, something like that.
And what made you do this?
Supporting the design process. You're raising another interesting point that occurs to me. When I was 27 years old, I asked myself, what kind of purpose in life would I have, mm-hmm. did I want to have? And so what I did, I I like to structure things. So
I'm not surprising with architectural background, engineering. I mean, that is not one of, you know, out here.
Well, Marlene, what I did
was
I wrote this thing down when I was 27. I decided my purpose in life is to want to make life beautiful. That's it. And that's very subjective, of course.
Yeah.
But I lived by that credo ever since. And so everything I did, like the architecture, well, here were these beautiful new structures that I had a part in getting the project, you know, getting the commission, contracting for it, helping the process go through that we could actually materially create what we did without going broke.
Right.
So Winston Churchill actually said, first we shape our buildings and then they shape us.
And where did you do a lot of the architectural work, here or in? You stayed mostly in Southern California.
Yes, but we had, the first firm I was with, we had projects in the Chicago suburbs area and also in Florida along the coast. So I was traveling to some of those places and dealing with the commercial aspects involved with those, including with lawyers and, you know, things like that.
What did you like best about this?
Supporting that process. And I developed something, actually I learned from George Lucas indirectly. I saw this film that gave me the creeps when I was in college, THX 1138. It's this underground, chilling, you know, futuristic fantasy movie. I won't call it science fiction, but it was futuristic fantasy, and everybody's grim, and they're underground, and there's no love, and all this stuff. And finally, this one character played by Robert Duvall wants to escape, and he gets into some auto that looks like a rocket-powered Maserati, and he starts driving at 250 miles an hour in these subterranean tunnels, and he's going through all of that, and so the government or the powers that be are chasing him, and so they have these robot policemen on motorcycles that are chasing him, and you're hearing this dispatcher's voice, a female voice saying, "Officers are at whatever kilometers away from him." And closing, and we are operating at 80% of budget. So that gave me an idea on something we developed called predictive project budgeting, where you could compare the percentage complete that you were in a given phase of a project or the project itself, and then compare that with the percentage of budget consumed, and you got a new percentage called a budget status percentage, and that would predict for you, were you going to make it or weren't you? Were you going to go over budget or not? But there was still time to do something about it. So with this predictive project budgeting, you were able to, you could do about 10 things if you had time, you know, to change the destiny of where you were headed if it were not good.
Did you write this for the PC or or did you do the pen and pencil?
Predictive project budgeting began with mainframes. We actually, in that time, I did
that
systems analysis, put it out to a computer consultant who had the programming done, and then they would provide us with weekly printouts, you know, in those days, and great big 11x14 printouts. And then eventually it went to PCs.
Well, that sounds like a really good thing.
I thank George Lucas if he's out there seeing this.
No, I mean, really, that's something very good for businesses.
Or if you are in a service industry, or if you are on a project basis, if you are an aerospace company, or if you're Boeing, that's really complex because you're dealing both with labor cost, overhead, and materials. I mean, in architecture and engineering, it's only labor, overhead, and outside consultants. But the aerospace companies really have their work cut out for them. They have
and they have all that job costing to do, too. I mean, and that job costing is lots of layers of, because they're putting all those things together.
Each one is a project. See, like they get a new plane. That's a project. But think of everything that has to go into that.
Yeah, but they have all sub-projects, because mm-hmm. you've got the big project is the plane, but then you have whatever, the seats and all the bolts and everything that, right? It has to go with the seats, so that's, these are all costing at sub-projects.
Exactly.
Yeah, so you like that work.
Yeah, I like to, well, you asked me some question in the preview or the pre-screening for this program today.
Looking at your patterns. I call it looking at patterns.
Yeah, you asked about looking at patterns, and I answered some things, and then I showed my answers to a friend who's known me for many years, the friend said, well, one thing that shows up.
Your 10 favorite films, right?
Yeah, the 10 favorite films. Yeah, and he said, well, one thing that shows up is you like to shape your own destiny. And I hadn't thought of that, but yeah, it's true. And then the other thing two other things. He said, you're eclectic, and I said, yeah. And then he said, every one of these films you like, no matter what it's about, even if it's just an intimate tale like Mr. Holland's Opus, every one of these films is about a quest of some sort. You are a questing individual. Yeah, I said, yeah, and you don't know that about yourself. Other people have to tell you.
Yeah, and I find when I do that, there's always these patterns with what, like, I love my murder mysteries. I really do. I love good murder mysteries. I really like them. And then I like good sci-fi.
And, which, by the way, is a Westerns. Pejorative term with regard to science fiction that was coined by Forrest J. Ackerman way back in the 1950s. Because he was thinking hi-fi, okay, science fiction, sci-fi, but sci-fi is actually demeaning. It's kind of space opera, overblown kind of stuff. But true science fiction, SF, we call it, is actually more serious. It has more science in it. It's not just futuristic fantasy. It actually is connected with science, as with the Interverse story, for example. So I always put a deal in there, because most people think sci-fi, oh, well, that's just one category. Actually, no. Among we characters who try to create it, that's a lower level of stuff than what you aim for.
What would you call the origin of Star Trek?
Star Trek was quite science fiction, yeah, because they had a lot of science. And especially Next Generation was very highly focused on science. With the original generation, but still had quite a bit of science. And people like Isaac Asimov, Theodore Sturgeon, even in the original Star Trek, were consultants to Gene Roddenberry on that.
And what about Forbidden? That's one of your favorites.
I did do material that was in some of the Star Trek films. I did manage to get some of my writing without credit into Star Trek III, and then I wrote a formula on how to do a Star Trek, and that was used by Nick Meyer, who was the actual screenwriter of Star Trek IV. So I did actually get stuff in there, and I got a nice letter back from Gene Roddenberry on it, but no credit.
No credit
and no compensation.
Well, in when I was looking at it, Forbidden Planet's one of your that's a good one.
That's very scientific and very advanced. I mean, you're getting out to...
Do you want to tell about the premise of this one?
Well, yeah. I mean, you're talking about a species that don't even see in the movie, but they are so beyond us that they were on the verge of manipulating all energy without touching it or anything. They could all do it telepathically. They could manipulate the energy on their planet, and yet in one night they all they died off. They killed themselves in one night because of something eons before they had no concept of, the unconscious mind. Mm-hmm. That they didn't realize they had these resentments and hatreds and everything like that that came out. So as soon as their conscious minds were able to use this energy, their unconscious minds could do. And so they just, through mutual revenge, wiped each other out. And it's a powerful story and a greatly done film. I believe.
I was going to ask you, because your film you have good backgrounds and everything. So let's go back. So let's go back. Now we're moving around here, and I want the audience to understand because you. I can't do linear with you. I mean, we have to move in and out.
I could not frame my house, believe me. There are a lot of things.
Well, yeah, but so then you did the consulting. Then what happened? How long were you in business?
Oh, decades.
Okay. You really made it in business on your own rather than being employed, right?
Well, I paid a price, too. I mean, because they're... you know, when you're doing these other creative things, they very often don't pay.
Right.
And you're doing your primary career, which gets you through. But I would say, I did okay, not great. It's just okay. But I did manage to create what I wanted to create. So that's been very, very satisfying.
Well, because, I mean, you're creative within the scientific community. I could probably put you in that. So, I mean, you have the balance of the science and the abstract of the creativity. And, you know, because I want the audience to understand that what we do in creative, what happens in creative fields, rather, versus jobs or different types of self-employment. It's this up and down and a merry-go-round, so or hill.
Yeah, Marlene, that's another great subject, and you've tripped me off on something else again. Beethoven made as much money as a bank clerk.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Franz Schubert was starving and died at age 31. These things typically never pay. I mean, yes, some people make it and sell a lot and their work gets disseminated, and but overwhelmingly, no, it doesn't pay. And so you have to just love it for what it is. I think Van Cliburn once told aspiring young pianists, don't take this up unless you have to.
Really?
Yeah,
so you're one of the few people that has worked both ways, and I thought this would be good. I want to talk to you for the last couple minutes about Tokyo.
Yes, this is part of
a
two-part presentation. This is the first one, originally not intended as a prequel, but this was a film originally created by Gary Ono, about his father, who, unbeknownst to the family, Gary Ono's Japanese-American, his father was also born in San Francisco, was a broadcaster of Allied propaganda to Japan during World War II. And this is a documentary, half-hour documentary, where I joined in with Gary, became a co-producer, rewrote some of the content, restructured it, hired a narrator, and so on. And we did this, and now we're in post-production on the sequel to this called Voices Fight an Empire. And this is about the Allied propaganda leaflet campaign in the Pacific War against Imperial Japanese forces that had results that are just completely unknown today and are very relevant, because this campaign was far more effective than people realize it was. And we face the same thing today. For example, in the Middle East, where there are confrontations, battles, wars going on, but very little understanding of the opposite side and empathizing with where they're coming from, and then being able to communicate and even negotiate and alter the outcome with far less loss of life. So the Calling Tokyo and Voices Fight an Empire, I believe, are other important projects. Now, Calling Tokyo was on PBS. We had 69% of the PBS stations made over 1,700 airings in 2014. It's still going. Let's see what happens with Voices Fight an Empire, which I believe will be the end of the couplet.
What did you, how much work was this one? I mean, going, you knew you were going to target PBS. You didn't target anybody else as your target audience? It was mainly the
We
people.
Checked a little bit, but other people said, well, you know, what's your track record in commercial TV? That.
Right, right.
So PBS said, well, we like this. This is nice. We're just not, we don't pay. You sell videos. That's what you do. But that's what Ken Burns did also with his various documentaries. He was very successful by doing very widely appealing documentaries that have been commercially very successful and funded many of his ventures.
So would you like to stay, do more programs in the PBS realm?
Well, this Voices Fight an Empire, I think we're looking at a broader possible exposure for that.
Okay. So anything else you want to say while we sum this up about your life?
Okay, well then I do have the three television shows.
Okay, okay.
We have Economic Solutions, which is a
well,
research
say you're
and
producer,
presence.
You're a producer here.
Yeah, I'm a producer and the host, and we bring in people live and also by electronic communication. We look for answers to economic issues. So we define the issue, we research the issue, and we present what we find. But we don't come in with a preconceived notion. We present what we find. We have a second one, Science Solutions, where we bring in prominent scientists to try to solve practical problems of the day. And then we have a third one called Public Policy Review, where we just try to review certain policies or people in it without taking sides, just to present some information.
Do you like doing all three shows?
Yeah.
It works with all your background in international relations, right?
What's fun about it is that the CEO of this station said once, well, Zane, we'd like to have more of your shows, and when's your next show? And I said, I don't know. I just do them when I feel like.
Okay.
Which is, I love that kind of freedom.
Okay, okay. And your shows are on KGEM?
Mm-hmm. And they're also on the internet. And my website is Intraverse, I-N-T-R-A, V as in Victor, E-R-S-E, .com. So that's my website that shows the various programs and the various things that I do. With regard to media, it shows my resume background, and it gets into the Economic Solutions, Science Solutions, and Public Policy programs with links. So those are all available there. And for very intrepid folks, I also have a blog where I talk about everything and sometimes get myself in trouble.
Okay. And then you have your books on Amazon.com.
Yes.
Okay.
Anyway, and I also very much appreciate your having me here.
Well,
it's very nice of you to invite me to come and blab.
Okay, thank you.